Okay. So I'm going to talk about sampling, like many of the previous talks, but I'm actually not going to talk about filtering or sequential sampling in this talk. I'm going to talk about essentially inverse problems or parameter inference problems where you have all the data available to you, and the challenge is then to explore the posterior in an efficient manner. And I should mention, this is joint work with my PhD student, Matt Parno, who just defended a few weeks ago. So the kinds of problems that we're interested in are typically ones where you have all the data, you have some complicated forward model, and you'd like to learn parameters inside the model. It could also be initial conditions, boundary conditions, and so forth. The data are typically limited, limited in number, noisy, and indirect. The forward model can be expensive. The parameters can be high dimensional. So many of the features that you see in the filtering problem are here, but the challenges in some sense are different. I'd say in some sense that the priors are easier, but the observation operators are more difficult in these problems. Since this is a geophysics conference, I'll also give another application we've been working on, which is learning parameters describing ice-ocean interaction in Antarctica. And this is joint work with Patrick Heimbach at MIT. So the approach that we're adopting is Bayesian, and I hardly need to describe that to this crowd. So the central idea is that we're describing our model parameters as random variables, and our goal is to explore this posterior distribution shown here in green. And essentially, the computational task is to extract information from the posterior by evaluating the posterior expectation of some arbitrary function here written as f. So pi is my target distribution. This is the shorthand I'll use for my posterior, and I'd like to extract information by being able to evaluate these expectations efficiently. And one way to do that is to generate samples from pi. So in the context of posterior sampling, one of the workhorse approaches for any kind of Bayesian computation is Markov chain Monte Carlo. And Markov chain Monte Carlo is working this very, I'll cartoon it in this very simple way. Suppose I have a complicated distribution that I'm trying to sample from, very non-Gaussian. I can propose from something easy that I know how to sample from, for instance, a Gaussian. I propose from this distribution whose contours are shown here in black, and then I accept or reject depending on where the sample is relative to the contours of the more complicated distribution. So this, MCMC recipe encompasses, a whole myriad of algorithms. And the essential idea behind designing a good MCMC algorithm is how do you design a good proposal distribution queue? So good mixing of the algorithm, making your samples as close to independent as possible, requires designing a good proposal distribution. So what makes for a good proposal distribution? In some sense, a good proposal distribution is one that is adapted to the target. So in this case, on the left, this proposal is not so great for this target. But on the other hand, on the right, this proposal will work pretty well for this target distribution. And the sort of key message behind this talk, if there's one thing that you remember, is that what we'd like to do is figure out how to transform proposals or targets to improve better sampling. So in other words, we would like, and these, we'll actually show these are kind of equivalent. Either I want to take the black thing and make it better adapted to the target distribution, or I want to take the target itself and transform it in a way so that it becomes more amenable, more sort of well mated with the proposal distribution that I'm using. And the idea that we're going to use to do this really draws from optimal transport. So optimal transport essentially looks at this problem of how do I rearrange probability mass or mass in general from one distribution to another. And in this cartoon here, I have a reference distribution here denoted with the random variable r. I have a target distribution with random variable z associated with it. And optimal transport has a very rich literature about how to do things like find optimal ways of rearranging one distribution into the next. And one can impose things like transport costs, various ways of addressing the uniqueness of this problem, because there's no unique solution unless you regularize it in some way. But you can show that there exist maps under certain conditions on the reference and target. Another map that is useful computationally is a triangular map, essentially a Rosenblatt rearrangement from one distribution to another, which is a rearrangement based basically on conditional CDFs of basically a disintegration of the target measure into a series of conditional CDFs. So in some previous work, we've looked at finding maps from the prior to the posterior. And this actually has interesting connections with implicit sampling, which has been discussed here. One of the main differences is basically whether you include this Jacobian determinant term in your objective or not. And that actually affects whether you end up with weighted samples or not. If you include the Jacobian determinant here, then in principle, you can generate samples from the target distribution that are not weighted. And I say in principle because you have to parameterize the map. And so you've really transferred the problem to how do I describe this map for an arbitrary target distribution. The map that maps to that target distribution from a Gaussian reference might be complicated, might be difficult to describe in some basis. So what I want to talk about today is how can we use approximate maps? In particular, how can we combine approximate maps with Markov chain Monte Carlo sampling? So the previous optimization problem could be costly. The maps have to be approximate, but I still want to achieve exact sampling in the sense of drawing samples from the exact distribution. And the idea will be, okay, let me combine the process of constructing maps with the process of sampling from the posterior via MCMC. And this is going to involve a combination of posterior sampling and the solution of a convex optimization problem to construct the maps. And you can think of this as really preconditioning the distribution as I showed you on the previous slide, either taking the target distribution and transforming it to something more Gaussian, more amenable to sampling. And you can also understand this in the framework of adaptive MCMC, where you can adaptively construct proposals that become better and better as you generate more samples. So how do we do this? The essential sort of computational ingredient is the ability to construct maps from samples. So if I have a candidate map T tilde, I could think of my reference distribution here. My exact target distribution is shown here in green. I'd like to find a map T tilde that pushes forward samples in the reference and makes them look as much as the target as possible. But I could also ask the question in reverse, like what if I actually had samples from the target, shown here in green, and I want to then find a way to take these samples and transform them to the horizontal axis in a way that makes them look as Gaussian as possible. Now I'll mention, you know, this is a 1D cartoon, but this process is going to generalize to higher dimensions. What happened here? So the idea is essentially to minimize the KL divergence between the target itself in green and the pullback of the reference through the map. So the map is written from theta to r, but I can consider the pullback of the map through the reference. So I minimize this KL divergence here that ends up becoming this objective here. Then the interesting thing here is that I can approximate this expectation using samples from the target distribution, and the quantities that I have to evaluate on samples from the target simply involve the reference distribution and the map. And so this actually is going to be a very useful structure computationally, because I don't need to touch the reference distribution once I've described it approximately with some samples. Some additional structure we impose on the optimization problem, we look for maps that are triangular. This actually makes, you can show that these maps exist under pretty general conditions, but this makes the Jacobian determinant lower triangular and thus very easy to compute. And also, when the target is a multivariate normal with identity covariance, then this optimization problem becomes nice in the sense that it's convex, and it's also separable across dimensions. So now I'm actually solving a different optimization problem for every single dimension. And, well, you can ask, how are the dimensions coupled? Well, they're coupled through the samples. The samples are joint samples from pi. But then to construct the map in each dimension, I have a separate optimization problem. And you can look at this from the perspective of sample average approximation. We're basically approximating that expectation using the samples. And we're going to represent the map in some basis then. So how do we put this back into MCMC? Let me just walk through the ingredients. The first ingredient is, okay, what if we had a static map? So the idea is basically, what if I just performed MCMC in the reference space, and I have the static map here, let's suppose I got it by some means, for instance, from some initial set of samples. If I make a simple proposal in the reference space, for instance, a Gaussian proposal, random walk, when I push it through this nonlinear map, it's going to be a non-Gaussian proposal on the target. Okay? And I can compute the acceptance probability this way, and the map enters into the acceptance probability. I could basically think of this as either doing MCMC with a simple proposal on the push forward of the target through the map, or I could think of it as doing MCMC with a fancy proposal on the push forward of on the pullback of the proposal through the map. These are equivalent. Now the next thing I want to do is, well, I'd like to update the map actually with each MCMC iteration, because I need samples to build the map. So there's this chicken and egg problem, which we resolve with adaptive MCMC. So with each MCMC iteration, we can update the map. Suppose I get new samples from the green. These are exact samples because I'm always metropolizing, I'm always correcting them with the Metropolis step. And as I generate more and more samples, I get a better approximation to that expectation, and my map may improve. And that is shown then by the push forward of the target through the map becoming closer and closer to Gaussian, like that. And then the third thing I might want to do is then adjust the kind of proposal that I make. So here's actually from a numerical example. The target distribution in the reference space is shown here. Here's the proposal. If I push it through the map and I have this banana-shaped target distribution, then the proposal is going to look non-Gaussian like that. But if the map is sufficiently accurate, what I might want to do is generate independent samples from the reference space, which then corresponds to Metropolis-independent sampler on the target, and can help you jump around the target space much more efficiently. So when the map becomes sufficiently accurate, you'd like to kind of avoid that random walk behavior and use an independence proposal. how to put that together, how to sort of jump between local proposals and global proposals. The solution that we're trying is a delayed rejection MCMC, where you basically have a first stage proposal that's aggressive, that's global. If that doesn't get accepted, then you go on to your more conservative second stage proposal. And what we find is that as the map evolves, initially when the map is not accurate, you have to go to the second stage a lot. But as the map gets better and better, then you can accept in the first stage and move on. So this entire scheme you can actually look at through the lens of adaptive MCMC, and you can use existing tools from adaptive MCMC along with some constraints on the map to avoid bad tail behavior to show that you actually can sample from the exact posterior as a result. So just to give you some quick numerical examples, this is a 2D example just for visualizing things. It's a very simple parameter inference problem, but the interesting thing here is that the target distribution is this very non-Gaussian and narrow-looking thing. If I use maps parameterized with third-order polynomials, after the MCMC has run, the push forward of this target distribution through the map ends up looking something like this. So we've transformed this very non-Gaussian distribution into something that is Gaussian and thus more amenable to MCMC sampling. More complicated example, this is a predator-prey model. We're trying to infer initial conditions and several parameters, so it's an eight-dimensional problem. The posterior looks something like this. So this is just one way of visualizing an eight-dimensional distribution that I have the marginal distributions on the diagonal and then pairwise marginals on the subdiagonal. And the point here is just that it has a complex structure. How does the sampling efficiency compare? Hope this is not too dense, but I just want to point out a couple of things. So on the top, I have some standard MCMC algorithms, so adaptive Metropolis, simplified manifold MALA uses gradients of the target to come up with a local metric. Adaptive MALA uses the sample covariance and a Langevin proposal using the gradient of the target to come up with better proposals. And then everything below the line is a transport map proposal. I would focus on the first one. This is transport map with a delayed rejection and a global proposal in the first stage. And what we're looking at here as a diagnostic is the number of effectively independent samples in a chain of a given length. And okay, so you'd like your number of effectively independent samples to be as large as possible because that shows you're getting close to actually independent samples. But samples come at a price, and you can measure this price either in terms of the number of forward model valuations you have to undertake. So if your posterior density is expensive, this is kind of the currency of cost that matters. Or you can measure it just in terms of wall clock time. And that's important because there is, of course, some overhead to solving these optimization problems and constructing the maps. So if we just take as our baseline a delayed rejection adaptive Metropolis, we actually can show that in terms of effective sample size per second, we can get about an order of magnitude gain. And in terms of effective sample size per evaluation, we can do even more. And the essential idea, it's also interesting to point out that these proposals, these transport map proposals, do not use derivative information from the target. But they're able to outperform these proposals that do use derivative information from the target. So just a few characteristics of the approach. The map construction has a lot of parallelism that one could take advantage of. We haven't done this yet. And you can also view this as kind of generalizing many current MCMC techniques. If the map is linear, then this reverts to an adaptive Metropolis kind of Gaussian proposal. As the map becomes nonlinear, then it does things like that. So just a few words on ongoing work. What we're trying to do now, of course, is extend this to higher dimensions. While it separates across dimensions, so in that sense the optimization problem is not too out of hand, the basis functions that you need to use in high dimensions become more and more expensive. So the essential idea that we're trying to look at here is this notion of a likelihood-informed subspace, which is to say that the departure from the reference may be limited to a few directions. And as your data become less and less informative, then the map in some sense reverts to identity in many directions. And that's the route towards higher dimensions. And of course, also looking at the nonlinear filtering problem. And if anyone wants to try this out, we do have code available for download.
Questions?
Yeah, we are finding a distribution. So the question is, if we have a target that's non-Gaussian, are we finding a distribution that minimizes the KL divergence selective? Yes, within the constraints of the space of maps you're allowing yourself to explore. So basically, this optimization problem is posed over some finite basis that describes the maps. And within that basis, we are minimizing the KL divergence between the target and the map-induced density.
So it seems like different choices
Yeah. No, so that's a great question. So the rationale we've taken is, okay, if you have linear maps, you restrict, and a Gaussian reference, you've restricted yourself to Gaussians. So we've kind of taken the let's add polynomials, let's do multivariate polynomials as a way of enriching that space in kind of an incremental way. We've also played with radial basis functions, which also linears plus radial basis functions, which seem to work pretty well. So I don't have a general response to the question, even what's the optimal choice of basis. That is actually something we're kind of thinking of. You can pose this optimization problem in infinite dimensions as an optimization over functions. Of course, in practice, you have to solve it in some finite dimensional space. But you can actually compute the first variation of the variational problem and use that as a clue towards how to enrich the map, sort of what basis you have not yet included. And so that I think that's a route towards answering that problem, but in general, it's hard.
Thank you. Okay.